Yes, our sexual identity is contingent in the sense of it's not biologically predetermined, it relies on symbolic facts and so on and so on. But if a decision is free, it can still be an extremely strong decision that you experience as fate. And here, Freud and Lacan follow this lesson of Kant, Schelling and so on, where they claim that the truly free decisions are unconscious decisions, which are experienced as fate. Like, I repeat myself, I was often using this example here, falling in love. Of course, it's a free decision in some sense. But as a free decision, you never decide. All of a sudden, it's absolute fate for you, if it's authentic love. Or, did I already mention this to you? Although at some point, I admit it self-critically, I had problems with India, but this is a standard joke from my Indian friends. They told me, oh, you are the most beloved India-phobic guy, no? But something so beautiful happened there. Did you read it? It was in our media, just those small news eccentric, which are worth following. A guy there, my God, a true speculative Hegelian India, sued his parents that they gave birth to him without his consent. And that's the freedom also of sexual identity and so on. You don't choose it consciously. It's not that, you know, that's an illusion that a small boy or girl or X eat. At a certain point, he asks himself or she or it, oh my God, what should I choose? No, that moment never arrives. But it's nonetheless a decision you are totally responsible for it. And that's where I would correct this usual pseudo, she's not so stupid, pseudo Judith Butler playful LGBT identity. Oh, I play, today I'm gay, tomorrow I'm hetero, then I'm asexual, and so on and so on. You know, this basic decision is your decision, but it defines yourself. Of course, I have nothing against the fact that your boss treats you in a nice way and so on. The problem is if this not only covers up the actual relationship of power, but makes it even more impenetrable. You know, if you have a boss who is up there, the old-fashioned boss, shouting at you, exerting full brutal authority, in a way it's much easier to rebel than to have a friendly boss who embraces you, oh, how was the last night with your girlfriend, blah, blah, all that body stuff, where then it almost appears impolite to protest. But I will give you an example, an old story that I often use to make it clear what do I mean by this. Imagine you or me, I am a small boy, it's Sunday afternoon, my father wants me to visit our grandmother. Let's say my father is a traditional authority. What would he be doing? He would probably tell me something like, I don't care how you feel, it's your duty to visit your grandmother. Be polite to her and so on. Nothing bad about this, I claim, because I can still rebel and so on. It's a clear order. But what would the so-called postmodern, non-authoritarian father do? I know because I experienced it. He would have said something like this. You know how much your grandmother loves you, but nonetheless, I'm not forcing you to visit her. You should only visit her if you freely decide to do it. Now, every child knows that beneath the appearance of free choice, there is a much stronger pressure in this second message. Because basically, your father is not only telling you must visit your grandmother, but you must love to visit it. If there is a point in psychoanalysis, it is that people do not really want or desire happiness. And I think it's good that it is like that. For example, let's be serious. When you are in a creative endeavor, in that wonderful fever, my God, I'm onto something, and so on, happiness doesn't enter it. You are ready to suffer. Sometimes scientists, I read history of quantum physics or earlier of radiation, were even ready to take into account the possibility that they will die because of some radiation and so on. You know, happiness is for me an unethical category. And also, we don't really want to get what we think that we want. The classical story that I like. I am married to a wife, relations with her are cold, and I have a mistress. And all the time I dream, oh my God, if my wife were to disappear, I'm not a murderer, but let us say, drop me, it would open up new life for me with the mistress. You know what every psychoanalyst will tell you quite often happens? That then, for some reason, wife goes away, you lose the mistress also. You thought, this is all I want, when you have it there, you turn out that it was a much more complex situation where what you want is not really to live with the mistress, but to keep her as a distance, as an object of desire about which you dream. Curzio Malaparte, an Italian author, first a fascist, then he moved to the left later in his life. In 1930-31, he wrote a book about technique of revolutionary coup d'etat, something like that. A wonderful and I think correct analysis of Bolshevik revolution. He went there and it was just before full onslaught of Stalinism, so he was able to talk with all the people and so on and so on. And he came to this result that the true genius of the revolution was even more Trotsky than Lenin. Why? Now, this may sound eccentric because it's not the Trotsky you maybe heard about. Lenin was in between when Lenin was a strategic genius. He saw a brief opportunity, we can grab power now, of the revolution. But basically, till Trotsky convinced him, converted him, Lenin remained a traditional revolutionary. His idea was gather thousands of workers and soldiers, attack parliament, imperial castle, whatever, big centers of power. Trotsky had an absolutely ingenious idea, and he did it. He says, but wait a minute, look at the modern state, how it functions. Forget about all that bullshit, the crowd confronting police and blah, blah. A modern state functions through just some 8, 9, 10 knots centers of technical centers of power. Railways, post office, phone, electricity, water supply, and so on. Before you play all those revolutionary games, storming parliament or whatever, in a discrete, quick operation, you should take control of this. And you don't need tens of thousands of people. We even know exact numbers. Trotsky said, I need less than 1,000 people. Dispersed, organized in groups of 20 with soldiers, I mean, people ready to fight, and especially good technicians. I remember the most sacred object, my own mother. Maybe you know the story. If you read some of my work, I write about it somewhere. My mother had an old Jewish lady with whom she was good friend. And once they had some business and then the Jewish lady left and my mother turned to me and said, you know, this is a wonderful lady, friend, but did you notice the strange, intense way she was counting money and so on? I think structurally this was the same moment as the one in all those wonderful paranoiac movies like Invasion of the Body Snatcher, you know, where aliens are among us and there is some tiny feature. They have too much skin here or a strange glow in their eyes that you recognize that they are really aliens. This counting money too intensely was my mother's identifying feature that lady may appear like one of us, but it's really a Jewish alien, and so on, you know. And those in power are getting ready of it. They're in China and so on, it's clear. But, you know, I don't like to mention China too much because we are doing the same thing. We just project it onto China as the evil one and so on. So I think that that's why we need, with all the mistakes he made, people like Julian Assange, WikiLeaks and all that. The real struggle will take place at this. If we don't somehow regain control over the digital network, those in power will still have the possibility to block, to sabotage any kind of public disorder and so on and so on. One of the absolutely crucial struggles is this one. I'm not saying it is the exclusive struggle. I'm saying that more and more, it's no longer, I even suspect that all that obsession with, you know, new nuclear arms race and so on, they're not really doing that. We are now, you should know this, in the middle of the new arms race. It's not only that Trump wants to step out of it. They are all for a decade already in it. But it's not so much nuclear arms. It's they're obsessed with new supercomputers, digital control, and so on and so on. And so, again, they know that, those in power know that if you have a big mass upheaval, if you suspend, if you sabotage, block the digital network, people are isolated, you can block it. The one whom I admire, do you have them here in Sweden? What in United States they call incels, involuntary celibates. Guys who openly accept that they are ugly, that they will not be able to find partners and so on and so on. I think this is our, they bring out some deep truth about sexuality. We are all incels dreaming about whatever. Means another thing that I want to very briefly emphasize here is that not only is sexuality not something innocent in itself, just spoiled by power relations and so on and so on. Often what I find even in a certain type of feminism, never forget that in the United States, most of the feminists supported attack on Iraq to liberate Iraqi women. Now, the result is that women are there oppressed more than ever, much more than under Saddam. But what I want to say is that you have also the opposite idea that it's not so much power relations of domination, exploitation that we should worry about, but we have also power relations which are good. But the problem is when they get sexualized. For example, at universities, people get disturbed when a powerful professor engages in sex with one of his students. I'm also opposed to it. But nonetheless, I don't like the implication that as long as the professor is just exerting all his authority, it's okay. Power, it's okay. As long as it doesn't get personal. So I don't like, for example, the type of feminism where you are not bothered by power relations, that less we women also want a proper percentage in it, no? A comical version of this happened in Slovenia, my country after independence, where a leftist government organized a group for women's rights, and the leader of that government office set as her first goal to organize a golf contest exclusive for women. Remember that golf was at that point the sport of the ruling nomenclatura. I didn't like this because, you know, like, the logic was clear. I don't care if the same power relations remain, just I want my part of it. You know, what is for me the worst kind of racism? I say this to provoke you. This patronizing celebration of the other. We, in relatively affluent Western white societies, we like authentic others. You know, the others who are not corrupted the way we are. I remember when I was young, a friend from South Africa gave me a brochure, it was still apartheid, South African brochure defending apartheid. And the reasoning was in a perverted way very multicultural. It was, but if we just introduce democracy in South Africa, you know, all those beautiful black minorities, Hottentot, Bushman, all these wonderful cultures will be drowned into our Western corruption. The most subtle racism today is not direct racism of you are less. No, it's you are more. We may be rich, but you, let's say you are some minority, but you live much more authentic, holistic life, and so on and so on. I have some Native American, I don't like the name. I prefer to call them Indian, and all my Indian friends prefer this name. They're intelligent, my friends there. They claim the term Native American is more racist. You know what was the reasoning? I'm sorry if I repeat myself, maybe you know it. They told me, Native Americans evokes the opposition nature-culture. So we have nature, what are you? Cultured Americans or what? White people. And they told me, we much prefer to be called Indians. At least our name is a monument to white men's stupidity, you know, who thought they were in India and so on. What I admire, my Native American friends, they hate these white liberals who come there, okay, you live your authentic life. Their message was, they told me, okay, then let's exchange our roles. Give me your L.A., Los Angeles suburb villa and you come to live in our city wooden house there and so on. You know, what I really, this is the most hated, this white attitude of this underprivileged group have some kind of deeper holistic authenticity and so on and so on and so on. All the minorities I know, and that's where I love them. No, they really want to succeed on our terms in our society. How do we find reactionary racism? You know what was my answer? With progressive racism, then. What do you mean? Of course, I didn't mean racism. What I meant is the following things. Of course, racist jokes and so on can be extremely oppressive, humiliating, and so on. But the solution, I think, is to create an atmosphere or to practice these jokes in such a way that they really function as that little bit of obscene contact which establishes true proximity between us. And I'm talking from my own past political experience, ex-Yugoslavia. I remember when I was young, when I met with other people from ex-Yugoslav Republic, Serbs, Croats, Bosnians, and so on, we were all the time telling dirty jokes about each other. But not so much against the other. We were in a wonderful way competing who will be able to tell a nastier joke about ourselves. These were obscene racist jokes. But their effect was a wonderful sense of shared obscene solidarity. And I have another proof here. Do you know that when civil war exploded in Yugoslavia, early 90s, and already before in the 80s, ethnic tensions, the first victim were these jokes. They immediately disappeared. Because people felt very well that, for example, what? Let's say I visit another country. I hate this politically correct respect. Ooh, what is your food? What are your cultural forms? No, I tell them, tell me a dirty joke about yourself and we will be friends and so on. It works. So you see this ambiguity? That's my problem with political correctness. No, it's just a form of self-discipline which doesn't really allow you to overcome racism. It's just oppressed, controlled racism. This is the images we see. Poor refugees saved in the last moment from drowning in the sea. That's, of course, tragic. But what we need to do in cinematic terms, Alfred Hitchcock often used this, is the shot begins here and then slowly we withdrew the camera till we see what in old Marxist terms we call the social totality. What is going on? We should begin to ask the real question of who is responsible for it, and I don't think it's only the Western imperialism that is responsible. Whenever something happens in a third world country like Rwanda, Hutus, Tutsis, it must be a consequence of neocolonialism. No, sorry, things like ISIS, things like expansion of Islam and so on and so on. This is not a passive reaction, this is an active project. They are also active agents. I don't think that too much integration is good. I think what we need in our multicultural mixed society is a degree of distance. My ideal today is not to live together with all different races, culture, we all love each other. No, I admit it openly. There are things about them that I don't understand. Probably there are many things that appear weird to them in what I do. I want polite ignorance, and then from time to time, of course, it's wonderful. I claim that extremists looked closely at their life stories. They are not truly excluded. They are deeply fascinated by the Western culture, and they kind of fight with it deeply. They envy it. If anything, this wave of young people ready to fight for ISIS and so on, they react to a certain type of integration which didn't work. I love these marginal spheres where different identities intermingle and so on. This is usually the source of the site where interesting things happen. I'm just saying, don't enforce it. Mm-hmm. It's a catastrophe. I think the only way to fight the destructive aspect of global capital is through transnational connections. The problems we are facing today, intellectual property, ecological problems, and so on, biogenetics. These are problems which can only be properly approached through large international cooperation. I'm a little bit tired of this, how people say, oh, Europe is dead, it's over. Sorry, why then are so many people wanting to? Because they still have this dream. And it doesn't matter if it's an illusion. You know, as we all know in politics, illusions have a certain political efficiency. And this illusion is not a bad one. Europe means a land, place where you can combine a certain level of freedom, safety, with social solidarity, minimum of welfare and so on. This part of European legacy is worth fighting for. This is why the formula of totalitarianism is not, I don't care what you think, just do it. This is traditional authoritarianism. The totalitarian formula is, I know better than you what you really want. And I may appear to be forcing you to do it, but I'm really just making you do what without fully knowing you want, and so on and so on. So in this sense, Yes, I am horrified by this. Also, another aspect, this new culture of experts, where an injunction is presented just as a neutral statement. For example, one example that I like, and let's not have a misunderstanding here, I don't smoke, and I'm for punishing tobacco companies and so on and so on. But I'm deeply suspicious about our phobia about smoking. I don't buy it that this can be really justified just based on scientific knowledge, how cigarettes hurt us and so on and so on. Because my first problem is that most of the people who oppose smoking then usually are for legalization of drugs and so on and so on. But my basic problem is this one. Look, now they found a more or less solution, e-cigarettes, electronic cigarettes. And I discovered that now big American airline companies decided to prohibit them. And it's interesting to read the reason why. The reason is not so much that it's not yet sure are they safe or not, basically they are. The idea is that if you smoke during the flight a cigarette, you publicly display your addiction. And that is not a good pedagogical example for others, and so on and so on. I mean, I find this a clear example of how a certain ethics, which is not just neutral ethics of health, but basically I think it's ethics of don't fall into it, don't have a too passionate engagement, remain at a proper distance, control yourself, and so on.
Everyday racism, especially in our liberal societies, is always like this. Many of my liberal friends have this more complex attitude. I love them, the other. Jews, Arabs, Palestinians, blacks, whoever. But, and it's interesting, it would be nice to make a list of these buts, what bothers you. One standard excuse of my racist, subtly racist friends is their food smells bad. I just cannot stand that. I love them, but their music is too loud. This was the standard complaint of white liberals, anti-racist, of course, in United States. Yes, we should help blacks, only if they would not be carrying those big radio boxes. This is what bothers you. But now comes my more problematic point. I don't think that we should here shift the accent to too quickly culpabilizing ordinary people. For example, recently I followed a debate in the United States where a white woman was walking on the street and she somehow, I don't know how, did she turn around or what, noticed that there is a big, strong black guy walking behind her a couple of steps and she automatically grabbed her purse. More strong. And the black guy complained this was an act of racism. Yes, I agree. But I think it's too simple to just blame her. You know, to claim she's a racist and so on and so on and so on. Because maybe that was her experience. Not that she was robbed by black people, but the society she lives in, and so on and so on. And what if she then comes with statistics claiming, yes, many robberies are made by black people, and so on and so on. So I'm always distressed when something that's part a systemic problem is turned into a moral problem for individuals. Okay, that woman was afraid. What should she do? Should she reason like, oh my God, yes, we whites oppressed black people, so please come and rob me. We are guilty and so on. And I think that we shouldn't reason at this level, but precisely, to put it in very naive Marxist terms, we should ask, but why are many black people So excluded that the only way for them is to steal a little bit? And the problem is there. What is pushing eventually? What is pushing black people towards this? How to change things at this level? Because you know that about it's about 50-50. Half of the movies I write about, I haven't seen them. No, I'm here a Hegelian idealist. I read about the movie, an idea came for me. Then I'm afraid to see the movie. It may spoil my idea. You see that it's a little bit... For example, the one, Black Panther.
Yeah.
I wrote about it, I didn't see it. Roma, Cuaron, pretentious. I didn't see it. So, but from what I've heard, I would be totally, basically... I'm not saying I know the main actor is good, blah, 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 but... you know why opposed it? Because if I'm informed correctly, the movie tries to give some kind of social psychological genesis of Joker, desperate circumstances, blah blah, all that stuff. I think with these negative superheroes, this is precisely the wrong approach. You cannot account for them in this way. They are kind of a miracle. They are, of course, effect of certain causes, but a contingent effect. The majority of people don't become jokers, you know, even if they suffer in the same way. I remember here a line from, I think Hannibal Lecter says, when they investigate him, when he is in prison, how could you become Lecter? The police psychologist looked into what happened to you, what trauma, so that you became. And he gives a beautiful answer. He says, nothing happened to me, I happened to the world, in the world. And it's the same with Joker, who is, of course, for me, a positive guy, a good idea, from the second Christopher Nolan movie. You know, precisely... If you read it, it's as if that movie, I think it's the second Christopher Nolan, The Dark Knight, where we have the famous Joker. Okay, what I like there is that Joker often talks there about his origins, but gives a series of inconsistent narratives.
Yeah.
Once he says this, then he says that, father beat him, father didn't beat him, whatever. And I think this is a nice way of mocking this history of origins. I don't believe in them. I think something always emerges, something new, as a miracle. At an American rich campus, there was a swimming pool. Student girls were there in their bikinis swimming, and next to the swimming pool was a building where the facade was being remade, of course, by half illegal Mexican workers. And Mexican workers behaved a little bit, not aggressively, but nonetheless, like male chauvinists, and were throwing at women this kind of no threat, but this kind of hola, erotic, sexist remarks. And the women complained that they felt threatened. And then, instead of confronting the problem, you can imagine what the university authorities did. They built under plastic a special tunnel to that building and made a big plastic wall to separate totally the two groups. And then there was an entire conflict because the ladies claimed we were victims of male aggressivity. The men claimed, no, it's class distinction. That these were rich ladies, we were too low for them, and so on. So I think that the sad lesson that I take from it, especially in the United States, where many upper middle class feminists, they don't say it, but implicitly, when they talk about male chauvinism, it has this subtle class and race dimension. You know, it's mostly Mexicans and so on who do this and so on and so on. I was shocked by this statement. We all know about it, of American Psychological Association, which declared toxic masculinity an illness. First, are we aware what they did? 5 decades ago, it was homosexuality, which was medicalized. Now they take masculinity, aggressive, clear social ideological product, and they medicalize it. If you read the description of toxic masculinity, it goes that it's a male attitude of when you are in a difficult situation, instead of reaching out to others, you enclose yourself into yourself and act out aggressively, hurting not only others, but maybe even yourself. I'm sorry, I'm just shocked here. In some situations, and we call this courage, you have to act like this. And the greatest examples that come to me, at least in history, and I will name you two examples, one ancient, one ultra-modern, are exactly women. If there was a toxically masculine agent, it's Antigone. Instead of going, Creon, let's debate, and so on and so on, she stands on her own in a very dogmatic way, and sometimes we need dogmaticism. I will tell you a wonderful story, simple one. It happened to me a year ago, around the corner here in a bookstore, I was signing a book of mine. Two black guys came, African-Americans, I don't like the term, my black friends also not. Because for obvious reasons, it can be even more racist. But the point is, and they asked me to sign a book, and seeing them there, I couldn't resist the worst racist remark. When I was returning the books to them, I told them, you know, now I don't know which one is for whom, you know, you blacks like yellow guys, you look all the same. They embraced me and they told me, you can call me nigger. You know, when they tell you this, it means we are really close. They instantly got this. Oh, another stupid problem I had. At some talk, there was a mutant deaf guy, and he asked if a translator can be there. And I couldn't resist it. In the middle of the talk, in front of 200-300 people, I said, what are you doing there, guys? My idea was, if you watch the gestures of the translator, it looked to me as some obscene messages or what. The guy laughed so much, we become friends. Not all, and some old stupid lady reported me for making fun of crippled people. It was so, didn't she see? That's how I became friend with the guy. But I'm, wait a minute, now I'm not an idiot. I'm well aware this doesn't mean we should just walk around and humiliate each other. It's a great art how to do it. I'm just saying that's my hypothesis. Without such a tiny exchange of friendly obscenities, you don't have a real contact with another. It remains this cold respect and so on, you know. There is something so fake about political correctness. I know it's better than open racism, of course, but I wonder if it works, because, you know, I never, for example, bought all this permanent replacement, you know. Niggers are Negroes, Negroes are black. Okay, black are African Americans. Maybe, it's up to them to decide. The most racist thing is to patronizingly elevate us in that, you know, primitive, organic, living together with Mother Nature. No, their fundamental right is to be evil also. If we can be evil, why shouldn't they be evil? And so on. The crucial point for me is that it says, I would prefer not to. Not, I don't prefer to do it. So it's not that predicate is denied, it is that a non-predicate is asserted. And I will say, what's the difference? Kant gives a wonderful difference, establishes it, which is why he's for me the greatest theorist of zombies. Look, if I tell you, you are not dead, I deny a predicate. What does this mean? It means simply, you are alive if you are not dead. But if I say, and I hope you know Stephen King and all that, if I tell you, not you are not dead, but you are undead, this means something different. Living dead, monster, and so on. And this, between the two domain, this is in a way the domain of spirit, in the wonderful ambiguity of the word. Spirit Geist means spirit as pure thinking, and Geister, those who make us fear, terrorize us. And I think this ambiguity is crucial. This is what Hegel is about. This is the best example of what Hegel calls bestimmte Negation, determinate negation, that negation is part of what an object is, what it did not. So of course, materially, coffee without milk is the same as coffee without cream. It's just plain coffee. But it's not the same. And this precisely because it matters what it negates. And I will give you a wonderful variation of this joke from my youth. When, you know, I lived in a communist country, it wasn't too bad, liberal communism, but nonetheless. I remember the joke was this one, because there were things, somebody enters a store and asks there, is it that you still don't have butter? And the person there answers, sorry, you're the wrong store. We are the store which doesn't have oil. The store which doesn't have butter is across the street there, you know.